stand with us if you're able. If you're new here, if it's your first time at CrossPoint, welcome. We're so excited you're here. We'd love to meet you in the lobby after the service. So if you just find your way to the new here spot, we'll be there to say hello. We're going to worship together. That sound good? Come on, let's sing together with joy as we praise the Lord.
Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to the right. I want to be on it. The road and the mercy is wide, because you're good on your promise.
Come on, let's sing.
And I'll take you at your word. If you said it, I believe it. I've seen how good it worked. If you started, you'll complete it. I'll take you at your word. You spoke.
You are.
Good. We can take him at his word. In Ephesians, where he says that he is able to do abundantly more than we can ask or imagine, we can take him at his word. That's why at CrossPoint, we believe that with Jesus, anything is possible. But I know that there are times in our lives, you may be in the room today, where there's a wall that's in front of you that seems impassable. And you know that Scripture says that that wall will come crumbling down, but it's hard to see it right now. Maybe you're struggling with anxiety, or maybe you're grieving a loss, or maybe you, like me, you've experienced depression. But what I know is in that season of my life, when I've come into the house of God and I've worshiped with the believers of God, I've seen others who have been through that, and their worship strengthens my faith. It's my hope for each of you today, if you're walking in that season, when that wall's in front of you, that you might be able to see someone else who's already seen the rubble on the ground. They've already walked because they know that God's done it in the past and he'll do it again. And we can believe that with Jesus, anything's possible. So let's worship out of that posture right now as Setnik leads us.
Thank you. God, you're so good to us. God, thank you so much for your love and your mercy and your grace. God, thank you for your faithfulness. Even when we're not faithful, you're always faithful. God, thank you for being there for us. God, we love you and we thank you for who you are. We love our lives in honor of you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Well, hey, everyone, and welcome again to CrossPoint Online. My name is Dustin, and I'm the online community pastor, and I'm here with my friend PK, the online campus pastor. We're really glad you're here today, and we believe that God has you here for a reason. If you're sensing God is calling you to take a step toward Him in some way, then I hope you'll be brave and lean into what God is calling you to do. He is faithful to give you everything you need to do whatever it is He is asking you to do.
Yeah, and one of the next steps we love to celebrate with people is when they decide to take the step of baptism. And when someone gets baptized, they're making a public profession of what God has done in their hearts. When we repent and believe in Jesus, He asks us to take this step as an act of obedience, just like Jesus did when He was baptized. It's a symbol of what Jesus has done for all of us and that He gave His life for our life. He died and came back to life in victory over sin and death. As we've been in this Crafted series, we have been talking about how the master artist, God, He crafts us over a lifetime into His image. One of the ways He does this is through baptism. No matter your age or your background in the church, He could be calling you and drawing you to Himself through taking the step of baptism. And next week is Baptism Sunday here. And if you'd like to sign up to get baptized and take that next step, you can text the word baptism to 615-615 to let us know that you're ready. And hey, if you don't live near one of our campuses, don't let that get in the way of you taking your next step. Reach out to us. We'll be glad to help you find a great local church and help you and a trusted friend navigate baptizing you. We're here to help you in your faith journey in whatever way that we can.
Yeah, and another way that we're crafted by God is through giving, because giving is a countercultural declaration that this world is not our home. This kind of investment, it simply cannot be lost. In Matthew chapter 6, verses 20 through 21, Jesus tells us, "Store your treasures in heaven where moth and rust can't destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Because wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also." If you call CrossPoint home, I want to encourage you to give today. If you're new around here, listen, there is no obligation or expectation at all to give. But if you do want to give, we've made it really simple. You can go to crosspoint.tv/give, or you can text GIVE to 615-615 to make your contribution. And if you normally attend here online, make sure you select online as your campus. Thank you all for your partnership in helping people find and follow Jesus.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. And I wanted to update you all on some bittersweet news. I have loved leading our online community, but with mixed emotions. I want to share that I'll be moving off of staff and into a new role outside of ministry. I want you to know that even though I'm transitioning to a new vocation, my heart for CrossPoint remains the same. Together with my family, I'll continue to attend and serve and call CrossPoint our church, and I would value your prayers for the CrossPoint team as they all begin the hiring process, but also personally as I make this transition. I'm grateful for the time that I've been able to spend on staff here at CrossPoint. Connecting with each of you and leading in the digital space has been such a deep joy of mine. I'm thankful for each of you who I've had the opportunity to interact with. You all have made this past season one of the greatest times of ministry in my life, and I love you, CrossPoint Online. And I look forward to seeing how God moves through the next online pastor. Again, I love you, and please reach out if I can ever do anything for you.
We love you, man.
Love you too.
For many of us, PK has been more than just a spiritual leader. He's a friend, an encourager, and a cherished member of our community. And if you've spent any time here, you'll know he has an infectious optimism and a deep wisdom. And he also has such a pastor's heart, a love for others, and a compassion that brings deep comfort. Even though PK will be transitioning to a new vocational role, I know his work community will benefit from his exceptional leadership and from his deep faith. And while this transition might bring a touch of sadness, we're also filled with gratitude. Gratitude for all the time we've been blessed to have him here, and leading the charge at our online campus. And PK also has these incredible gifts of vision and drive, and So much of what we've built in our digital space is thanks to these gifts he carries. And here's the beautiful part. While PK may be moving on, his place in our church family remains unshaken. PK will always be an integral thread in the fabric of CrossPoint. We wanted to share this with you all so that together we can celebrate his new chapter, support him in his journey ahead, and continue to lift up his family in our prayers. Thank you again, PK, for all that you've done to craft the online campus here at CrossPoint. We're headed into week 3 of our series Crafted, and we have a special guest today. But before we hear from them, let's hear from Pastor Kevin.
Hey, CrossPoint, this series has been so powerful. And I hope you've been following along. We've been learning together about the way that God shapes us, informs us, how he refines us, and helps us discover who we were created to be in him. You know, I've been dreaming about today for quite some time. I mean, for 7 years, really. I mean, since the time that God called our family from Georgia, Northeast Atlanta area to Cross Point. And we left our extended family and we left a church that we love. And frankly, we never thought that we would leave. The church is called 12 Stone and it's a multi-site church in Gwinnett County. And one of the reasons that we love that church so much is the leadership. Our lead pastor, Pastor Kevin Myers, and being at that church, like we were able to experience some God's favor, a move of God. And it was one of the fastest growing churches in the country. And what I so admire and respect about Pastor Kevin is that through all that growth, he remained humble and stayed faithful in the middle of it, giving all the glory to God. And I learned so much from watching him. You know, they say that a lot of people can handle adversity, but if you really want to see what somebody's made of, give them success. And I watched Pastor Kevin live with such dependence on God. And I learned so much from him. It's why when we were talking about doing the series Crafted, I wanted you to hear from him. Because Pastor Kevin is somebody that God has used in my life personally to help shape me and form me. He's been like a spiritual father to me. And he's said the hard things and he's demonstrated the grace and offered up words of wisdom and friendship and faithfulness. And it's an honor that he's with us today. So I want to ask you to whisper a prayer, just asking God to speak to you. And then I want to ask you to put your hands together and let's welcome Pastor Kevin to CrossPoint.
Well, I love Pastor Kevin Queen and Ree and the family and this church. And thank you for letting me hang with you for the weekend. I want to say something right off the top if I can. You probably don't need to hear it, but I'd like to say it. And the first thing is this. God's hand is on this church. Listen, God, you are a great church. And God has a calling upon this church greater than you even know or experience. And you should just pause for a moment. When you're a part of something that is so good, you kind of get used to it. You forget how good it is. Just go ahead and take a moment and tell God, thank you for our church. Just whisper it to him. Thank you for our church. And while we're at it, listen, God has his hand on Pastor Kevin Queen. I call him KQ. It gets confusing between two Kevins. So I'm PK, he's KQ. So I call him KQ. But listen, you have a great pastor in Kevin Queen and his wife, Ree. And listen, this is October. It's National Pastor Appreciation Month. He doesn't want me to do this, but I think y'all should do this. I think y'all should give it up in gratitude to honor your pastor, his wife, their family, and all the good that God is doing through you guys. I promise you, you have a great pastor. He is anointed by God, and he is worthy of being followed. So today is a couple of firsts for me. It's my first chance to be here on a weekend like this. Grateful to be here. But there's a second first, and this first was the first time Kevin Queen schooled me for teaching. Let me just explain. Long ago, in a galaxy far, far away, called Atlanta, before KQ was as good as you know him to be, I invited him to be a campus pastor alongside me. He was our first campus pastor at 12 Stone. And then sometime after that, while we were multi-campus, I brought him up and said, man, I'm going to start training you. You become teaching pastor alongside. And when I was teaching them, schooling them to be teaching pastor, I said, now, KQ, Queen, listen, you got to figure out how to fit inside my series. I don't want you to just go up there randomly, say whatever's on your mind. Here's the scripture I'm using. Here's how you fit in it. Here's what I'm doing this week. You fit here. Here's what I'm doing this. Don't steal my stuff for the future. Don't do a one-off where it looks like, where did that come from? So I get a phone call from KQ a few weeks ago. You know what he does? Now listen, I'm doing a series. Here's what I'm doing in the series. Here's the scripture you need to fit in. Here's what I'm doing before you. Here's what I'm doing after you. Don't steal my stuff. I mean, he schools me in the same thing. And I hung up the phone. I thought, well, that's fantastic. I'm now being schooled by the one I schooled. Here's the things he told me. We're in the book of Ephesians. Let's put the scripture up there. Look at this. Ephesians 2:10. The center of this conversation and what God's going to stir in you if you'll attend to him today. We are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. We're his handiwork. If you were here last weekend, KQ talked about, in the original Greek, it means poem. What it literally means is the hand of God is on you, and he's crafting you into his masterpiece. Then he gave us the illustration of Michelangelo and how he took this massive piece of marble and sculpture, took the hammer and the chisel and just sculptured, and over that 3-year period of time gets this 17-foot David that is the most famous of sculptures. And when asked, how did you do that? Michelangelo said, well, I just removed everything that wasn't David. Listen, we're having a conversation about God chipping away at your life to remove everything in your life that isn't Jesus. Biblically, the word is sanctification. Yes, it's a big word. In fact, I was proud of KQ for knowing that word and bringing it before you. I'm not so proud of you. That's a big word. But let's put a definition to it. You got a working definition in this series. I'll put it on the screen. Sanctification is the lifelong process by which those who follow Jesus are made more like him, empowered by the Holy Spirit for the purposes of God. See, sanctification is the chipping away. God's made you holy, and this sanctification is going to make you whole. God has imagined so much more for you than you have. Now in this conversation, KQ gives me this, here's what I'm doing, here's what you're doing, here's where I'm going next week. Don't steal my next week. I wanted to be honest with you. I did, because he's done that to me, but that's a whole nother conversation. But he pulled something, insight from Henry Nouwen that sits right inside scripture. It's when you look over Jesus' life, you see a pattern: solitude, community, ministry. And so KQ said, look, I'm doing solitude, which you did last week. Great teaching. Kevin, PK, I want you today to do community. And then next week I'll do ministry. Don't steal my stuff. Stay inside my series. Make it fit. So I'm ready. Are you ready? And by the way, this, when I'm teaching, I need you to help me. So I don't know what your style is, but I'll tell you what mine is, and you jump in with me. If I like say, are you ready? You guys say, we're ready. And if I say, I pause and I leave a word for you to fill in, but I've already said it, and you're going to repeat it, you repeat it. You're going to just join in with me. We're going to do this together. So I'll say, are you ready? And then you say, we're ready. Are you ready?
Ready.
Good. Let's do this. Let's get in. Because community is God's, you got to listen to this. You got to absorb it. Community, this is God's big idea. Community is how God sanctifies us. God uses you to chip away at me and craft me into the masterpiece God designs me to be. God uses me to chip away and craft Christ-likeness in others. Yes, the conversation last week mattered, solitude. And God chips away at you in solitude and prayer and connection with him in intimacy. But it's not enough. God created community for sanctification to happen. And you have to get in community. You have to get in community for four things to happen. And I want to lay these four things out on the baseball diamond, not because you care about baseball. You may not. Because I want it to be memorable and accessible. It's kind of the way I formed some of these thoughts back in the day to help my kids. It's how I raise my kids, how I disciple people. I help business people and mentor and pour into their life. And there's four things that have to develop. So we'll just kind of put it on the diamond just to make it accessible. If you want to jot it down, snap a picture, whatever. But this is what we're going to talk about today. That we have to get in community to get on purpose with God. It is in community that God forms us back into his purpose. We have to get in community, home plate, to get on purpose with God. Then first base, to get serious about sin. So in community, we help each other break through and get free from the things that imprison us. And then get in community, second base, to get past yourself. If you never get past yourself, you can't have full and fulfilling relationships. And then third base, to get better than you are. Get in community to get better than you are, because you can't become all that God created you to be, all on your lonesome. And ultimately, to bring that all back to the purposes of God. Now listen, to say this sounds simple. I'll just time out for a moment. I know that sounds simplistic. I know it's more complicated than that. We're going to teach through it. Try and be helpful. But it's as simple as saying, get on base and score. And as complicated as actually getting on base and scoring, like at the pro level baseball. I'm a fan of Atlanta Braves, and they've had a great season, 104 wins, equaled their best season in 25 years. The Atlanta Braves pays $200 million a year in salaries to baseball players to do what? To get on base and score. It's so easy. And yet, in postseason, while they're going after a championship, they have four games, and in those four games, they had 129 at-bats. And with 129 at-bats, do you know how many times they crossed home plate and scored? Eight. Why? Because it's really easy to say and really hard to do, because you got opposition. So we're going to teach through those four thoughts. And most of the time, I feel like I fail. Like, it is a battle. I mean, I struggle to get on base and get around this diamond. Anybody else struggle? Anybody else know that the things we're talking about are complicated? Just a second, but most of you are not. Are you that good? I mean, let me try again. How many of you struggle with the kinds of things we're about to talk about? Now look around, see the people not raising their hands. See the self-righteous? There's always some. If you're that good, write a book. We all need to read it. So let's sit at home plate. Let's have the conversation. Get in community to get on purpose with God. You know, when Ephesians 2:10 talks about us being God's handiwork, crafting Christ in us. This Ephesians, it's not just a place, it's not just a book in the Bible, it's not just a letter in the New Testament. It's a particular people. It's a church. Like saying CrossPoint. And Paul is writing to the distinctive of who these people are. Set apart from the rest of the world. Wholly committed to this chiseling kind of process where God is crafting you and sculpting you into his masterpiece. Because you are a peculiar kind of people. Now, if you're here, you don't know Jesus, you're invited in. God's drawing you to himself. Maybe you're spiritually unresolved. Glad you're listening in. Glad you're in the room. Glad you're at a campus. If you know Jesus, then you know there are distinctives about who we are, who you are in Christ. So look at the scripture when this book starts. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, by the will of God, by the what of God? Will. By the will of God. See, now we are a people who gets on God's will. We have our own will, but we surrender it to God's will. We don't do life by our will, our way. What makes us distinctive is whose will we seek to follow. See, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to God's holy people in Ephesus, to God's holy people, a distinct people who God has made holy and he's making whole in Christ. In fact, he goes on, the faithful in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father. He's not just the guy upstairs. He's not just somebody. He's not just a, you know, a being. Oh, I think there's a creator. I think there's somebody. I think there's something. No. You've settled it. He's my heavenly Father. There's an intimacy and an engagement and a definition to your life and who you are. He's not just God. He's God, my Father. My Father. He doesn't stop there. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord, not just Jesus. Our, your personal Lord and Savior, Jesus. This is a distinctive people. See, you are in Christ, which means you are for Christ, committed to Christ, seeking to do the will of Christ in a culture that does their own will their way. And so we get in community to help each other because God's using one another to chisel away our will, our way, so that we can be on God's purpose, his will, his way. I was in a conversation sometime back in 2018, and God used this person, this community, this conversation to shape me. It's a guy by the name of Jeff Foxworthy. He's a comedian. You may or may not have heard of him. Jeff wouldn't know me right now if he saw me, but I know him, and I got invited into a conversation with Jeff because he was going to do an interview with me for our church for a weekend series, and so it was awesome. I loved his comedic work, and if you've heard of him, then you know he's famous for You Might Be a Redneck. Anybody ever hear that stuff? I wrote some down. I didn't use it for service. We were just tight on time. But I wrote, I stole five. Can I do a little bit of You Might Be a Redneck? Can I do a little bit of that? Tell your neighbor, you might be a redneck. Just practice it. You might be a redneck. Good. Okay. Here we go. Here's stuff he's famous for. If you've ever cut your grass and found a car, you might be a redneck. If you think loading the dishwasher is getting your wife drunk, you might be a redneck. If you're offended, I did not write these. If you're offended that I chose them, KQ said these were great, use them. If you think the stock market has a fence around it, you might be a redneck. If you've ever financed a tattoo, you might be a redneck. If your dad walks you to school because you're in the same grade, you might be a redneck. So during this interview with him, as a person of faith, he was unpacking his journey, and I was surprised that he had a worse dad story than I did. I mean, it was rough. My parents got married in high school, never graduated high school, had to get married, ended up with four kids. Eventually, I was born their third when they were like 20 years old. They divorced when I was 10, 12. My dad was a spiritual leader of sorts, but had a different life simultaneously, so that it was incongruent. It blew up the family, lots of breakdown. And my dad and brothers moved out, and so I'm with a single mom and my younger sister. It was just a mess of a life. By the time I'm 16, I'm now a person of faith, and I'm sitting down with my dad as a 16-year-old saying, why did you lie? And I'm trying to have a come-to-Jesus conversation with my dad, and it did not go well at all. And then by 17, I'm, you know, just, I need your help for something, and he wouldn't help. So I settled at 17. I'm done with that, and I'll never ask him for anything again the rest of my life, and I never have. And that was the end of our relationship. So while I'm talking to Jeff Foxworthy, I'm 57 years old, and I haven't had a conversation with my dad in 40 years. He's never met his grandchildren. My kids have no idea who he is. They've never met. All they know is this, that my dad helped me be a good dad by teaching me how not to be a dad. And Jeff is talking about what his dad did, which was way beyond mine, and how he ruined his life, but he forgave and restored. And off camera, I'm like, tell me about that journey. And he tells me, and he said, well, I just, you know, God did this for me, and my dad, yeah, ruined my life, but, you know, he's my dad. So I had to forgive and restore. And I walked away from that conversation. I thought, wow, I'm past the need to get past that. I've forgiven my dad, but you, no, 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 no. And then I'm a few weeks later, and I'm in this season of praying and asking God, God, give me more of you. Give me more of you. Give me more of you. That's just because there's more of you to be had. And while I'm in this season, talking to Jeff, and more of you, God has a moment where he whispers in my soul and says, if you want more of me, you got to be more like me. I'm like, God, I am like you. I've been doing this forever. How am I not like you? He said, well, I forgive and restore. You don't. And sometimes you have to help God. He's busy. There's a lot of people. And so when he said that, I'm like, oh, you're wrong, but you're God. You know, you're not wrong often, but this time you are. And I gave him a list of all the people who have offended me along the way that I've forgiven and restored. I'm like, hello, evidence. And then God like made his list that started with my dad. I'm like, well, you're right. He says, so forgive and restore. And I'm like, you know what? I don't want more of you anymore. If that's what more of you is, no, thank you. I mean, like, I'm not doing that. How many, have you ever discovered what it means to follow Jesus and decided that's not the best idea? Okay, I'm going to put my hand up first, and then anybody else who wants to join, I'll just wait. I'll wait. Because that was a bad idea. I say, I want more of you, God. I want the will of God in my life. That is not easily done. I get thrown out, striking out at home plate on that thing often, because it works against my will, my way. And over the next several weeks, God messed with me until finally I yielded, and then I'm like, I don't even know what I'm gonna do. I got my dad's cell phone number from my sister, and I texted him. I'm 57, and I am nervously texting. Hey, you may remember you once had a third son. My name's Kevin, by the way. That's literally how the text sounds. I'm gonna fly up to Michigan for a conference thing. If you're available, would you like to do lunch? I mean, that's how dumb it sounds. And then we ended up doing lunch, and we had a really meaningful conversation and went all the way back to 16. Dad, you lied to me. He said, yes, I did. You lived a lie. Yes, I did. You ruined my life. Yes, I did. I'm so sorry. He's come to faith, and he's grown through it, and I've matured through it, and he was 77, and I'm 57, and we had a few tears, and we forgave and restored. And I came home and told my kids, hey, guess what? Your grandpa, dad, and I were, he's coming for Thanksgiving. My kids are like, everybody gonna show up for Thanksgiving this year. And so this is a picture of the first picture that my dad and I have had since I was 16, 17 years old, and with my kids and some of my grandkids, his great-grandkids, and that picture is a picture of the impossible. Because if you will get on God's will, God's way, his purpose, he can do in you what you could never do on your own. But you're gonna have to make some decisions to get in community, to get on God's purpose, and maybe that's why you're here today. And then you get to first base. First base is to get serious about sin. The Apostle Paul in chapter 1 describes now who not just who they are, but what God's doing in them. Look at this. For he chose us in him in Christ before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. So God is not merely saying, get on my will, but getting on his will, his way. And then he's going to, like in relationships, he's going to say, now you got, there's stuff you're going to have to just chip away. And in relationship, you're going to talk about, man, we got to get serious about sin and chip that stuff away because that's not Jesus in you. And that kind of stuff, listen, we got to get honest to God about what sin really does. We got to tell the truth about sin. Sin blows up your life. It destroys you. Sin promises pleasure but puts you in prison. And we got to be honest with each other that this is true. I'm coming off something of a sabbatical, and so I've not been working for a bit, just transitioned our church to a new senior pastor. I'm founding pastor. Anyhow, in that, I've had a lot of freedom, which means freedom to eat. It's fantastic. And I told my wife, I've got to get this 10 pounds off and get serious about getting fit. And within 24 hours, we're at a restaurant, and I ate healthy, reasonably, at that. And then we were driving away, and I said, you know, we're going to pass Crumble Cookie. How many of you know Crumble? Jesus is in that. Church, Crumble, very similar experience. And I'm like, well, you want, I know you love Crumble Cookie. And she says, yeah, but you're trying to be serious. I said, well, I am, but this is for you because I love you. Now, how many of you know what I'm doing? I'm just getting permission for my own sin. Which, by the way, let me just make a point. The reason to be in community in the church is not to give each other permission to sin. It's to help each other get free from sin. Well, that got quiet. Let's go back to Crumble Cookies. The truth about cookies is that they promise fun, and then your clothes don't fit. So we stop at Crumble, and I'm just going to get her a couple cookies, but they come in 4-pack. So I picked a couple that she might like, or somebody might. We're empty nesters, so I didn't know who was going to eat it. But and then we got home. I nibbled at one of them a little bit. And then that night, around midnight, I woke up, and I heard a voice in the house. One Jesus. One burglar. It was a cookie calling me. Don't tell me you don't know. Don't judge me. Do not judge me. How many of you know cookies, cakes, anything can call you? How many have felt the pull? I felt the pull, the temptation. I went down and had a sweet moment with that cookie. Certain clothes still don't fit. Why? Because I say I'm serious, but I'm not serious. Because if you're serious, you don't have to do serious things. And we were on this sabbatical. We had a trip, and part of it included London, England, and we visited places where John Wesley, God used him in a revival season in the 1700s that was crossed England and areas of Europe and came to the States and is profound. And you know what that movement was centered in great part? Accountability. What is the word? Accountability. They said get in community to get serious about sin. And for that to happen, you got to have accountability. And they would build relationships whereby each week they would sit down together and they would tell each other, where are you tempted and what are you doing about it? And tell me what sins you've committed and what you're doing about it. Because we got a spiritual war in our lives, and God has drawn a line, and he loves us too much to let us live in sin when, in fact, that's the thing that's blowing up our lives. So take it seriously and get help from one another, and let God, if you will, chip away at the things that cause you to fall into sin. Get honest to God about it. So when I planted the church, when Marsh and I planned the church, I went and built accountability with 2-3 other guys, and I'm still in accountability over 30 years where we talk honestly about what tempts us, what we're doing about it, where we sin, what we're doing about it, and how we fight that battle before God. Maybe that's why you're here today. Maybe you keep talking like you're living in freedom, but you're in prison because there's sins that are secrets. See, in these relationships of accountability, to get in community is to get in accountability, and you break the secret. In great part, breaking the power of sin requires you to break the secret. Maybe it's true you're only as sick as your secrets. And that can't be solved in solitude. That comes in community. Second base is to get past yourself. Now, the Apostle Paul gets blunt with Ephesians here, and he starts to urge him. He says, now, I got passion for this. Church, I want you to see this. I want you to experience this. I want you to understand it. Let's put it on the screen. Read this. Look at it with me. I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. In other words, really become fully sanctified. I urge you to let God do this complete work where he chips away all the things that are not Jesus, because this full and fulfilling life, this holy and whole life, the best of God in your friendships, the best of God in your single life, in your dating life, in your married life, in your family life, in your career, in your finances, you want to see the fullness of God? You want to see what God calls blessed? You go get your life free from sin, and then you get your life in a place where you truly could get past yourself. Look at that scripture again. I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely, this is it, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. I mean, you got to figure out how to get past yourself and love other people. It sounds like God, doesn't it? First and greatest commandment, love God, then love your neighbor as yourself. You got to get past yourself. As a habit, Marcia and I would go to the workout club on my day off, and on the way to the workout club, directly in front of it was an Einstein bagel. And then we would order a little, you know, thin, disciplined egg white bagel and then a cinnamon sugar with honey almond schmear on the side. But we were highly disciplined, so we would split the cinnamon bagel. So we only each got half. And then we would go work it off at the workout club. So when we ordered it, we go sit down at our seat. We sit down at a seat, we wait, and then they call our name. And because I love my wife and I'm here to serve and I love others first, I love her. So I walk to the counter. And when I get to the counter, I always have a dilemma, a battle, a problem. And here's what it is. I ask them to cut it in half, and they never do. What, how is this difficult? Measure it, get a ruler, and cut it in half. But they don't. One is always bigger. One is always better. One has more cinnamon sugar. One has more schmear. I mean, what are you doing? I said half. And I don't want to be aware of it. I'm just immediately, intuitively, I just go to pick it up and I'm like, that's better. I can see which half is better. I'm not trying to do this. I have a gift. And I know it's only a bite difference and a little bit of sugar, but that's the one I want. And so now I'm in a dilemma between the moment of picking it up and walking to the seat where I'm going to place half on Marcia's little napkin, which half am I going to put there? And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the essence of marriage. Because between the counter and the table, I'm at war inside. She has no idea. I'm like, what am I going to do? 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 I want to lick the one so that I say, you wouldn't want that. And then I put the better half of the bagel on her napkin without any conversation. And I am transformed if I will consistently do that. Months, literally years later, I used this in an illustration on a Sunday. And afterwards she said, oh, I had no idea you were doing that. What? I'm sacrificing like that all the time, repeatedly, and I'm getting no points? I mean, I want points. I at least want to be acknowledged for the sacrifice. So now she knows. You know, the secret of marriage is not that complicated. Give your spouse the better half of the bagel, whether they know it or not. Listen. No marriage survives when you take the better half of the bagel. And every marriage wins that gives the better half of the bagel. Marriage is nothing more than getting past yourself, which, by the way, is the secret to family and the secret to friendship and the secret to church and the secret to coworkers and the secret to team. Maybe the Holy Spirit has you here to just get out the hammer and chisel and say, you're going to have to get in community. Don't get away from it. Get in it. And when it's your turn, just give the better half of the bagel. Third base. Get in community to get better than you are. You know, God loves to grow things. And in Genesis, he tells us how he designed life, and that is with seeds. Seeds are the little things. Listen, if you never thought about it, God created seeds because he likes to grow things. Things are small, and he likes to build them into things that are big, beautiful, powerful, profound, that bring glory to him. You are in process of being sanctified, being made into his masterpiece. But he likes to grow things. And Ephesians talks about growing us into maturity. Instead of speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. See, Paul is talking about growing the church, growing the follower of Christ, growing the kingdom of God, growing you, and helping you become better than you are, because you have all sorts of lids and limits. You have talents and abilities, but they need to develop and they need to mature. You have thinking and ways of thinking and ways that you've been formed by the world, but you need to mature those and expand those, and you need to become more than you are. You have ways of life that eventually you will hit the end of yourself, and when you do, God says, kind of get a mentor and get bigger and better than you. If you think about it, this church in Ephesus from Paul was planted and then handed off to Timothy. Think about this. Ephesus, you're reading the letter. Paul started the church, but who took over the church and led the church, as soon as you get a little further into the New Testament, you discover that Timothy is the pastor of the church and Paul mentored him. If I could cut to the chase, I would just say this, get a mentor. get someone who's further along than you spiritually, because there are places God will take you in making you his masterpiece and crafting you that you can never get to without a voice that's beyond your experience. John Maxwell became a mentor of mine in my late 30s, absolutely transformed my life, and I could tell 100 stories. He's a leadership guru of sorts, but I'll just pick one story. About 2 to 3 years into the relationship, and he's helping me break through leadership and seeing things I'd never seen before, and just shaping my thinking and helping me see breakthroughs spiritually and the way I lead a team and build the kingdom, and then inviting me into doing conferencing. And I had, at that season of time, I had a son who was turning 15, a daughter who was turning 13, a third child who was turning 9. And listen, I wanted 4 or 5 kids when we got married. After I had a child, I wanted 4 or 3. After I had 2, I wanted 2. I'm just honest about it. My wife wanted 3, so we have 3. So we had 3 kids. And all, I'm good with kids, but I'm better with them the older they are. So once we got past the toddler state, you know, the infant, the toddler, they're adorable. Yes, love them, beautiful, wonderful, great. But like, nice to get past. I want to have a conversation. If you're going to cry, tell me why. I don't want to. Well, I don't know. If the passy doesn't work, we're done. I don't know what to do. And I need sleep. So you need to sleep. I just get me past that. I can't do that stage. So now I'm in my 40s. I'm being mentored. I'm growing my family. The kingdom's expanding. I'm loving life. John's helping me break through. And then I'm at this conference and my wife calls me. And all she said was, honey. And I said, that's not possible. Because if you've been married long enough, you know they just say something and you can feel it. I said, you can't be pregnant. We're in our 40s and we did stuff so that that can't be. And I don't want one. God bless them. I have 3. 3 is enough. No. Just no. Please, God, no. Yes, end of the story. We had a 4th. He's 20. He's in college. God, I love him. He's awesome. I wouldn't change anything. But let me get back here. But in the moment, yeah, I'm done. In fact, I wrote my resignation as senior pastor of our church and was contemplating walking out of ministry because I just can't publicly keep living a lie where I am so frustrated with God and my faith because I can't live this out. I don't want to start over in my 40s. It's killing everything I dreamed. And I sat down with John. This is the power of a mentor. He said, Kevin, you don't know what to do when a dream dies, do you? He said, listen, have a funeral and get a new dream. Write it down. Changed my life. Be honest to God about the loss. That dream is dead. Now get a new dream. Oh, what God could do if I would grow up to a new dream. God is the God of new dreams. He not only forgives and restores, he not only frees you from sin, he not only helps you get past yourself in relationships, but when things seemingly go wrong, even as you're trying to become the best he created you to be and get better than you are, he can plant fresh dreams in you. So what are you going to do with this teaching? You are God's handiwork. He's crafting you. But what are you going to do with it? What's your part? So CrossPoint, the band, so creative, so gifted, wrote a new song. They're going to sing it over you. It gives you a moment before the Lord. So here across the campuses online, would you bow your heads with me and prepare to receive that song? And I want to pray over you. Father, there are things right now going on in our soul, and it's as intimate and individual as we are. What do you want us to do with this? Maybe we're going to pick a base and say, I got to give attention to that. I got to get in community to see you get me back on purpose, or to help deal with this sin and be honest to God, or to get past myself, God, or I really do need a mentor. I need to be a mentor. God, I don't know what you're stirring, but you are sanctifying us. I pray right now for fresh capacity to hear, courage to say yes to you. And God, would you make us more holy like you and whole like you desire to. Do that over us, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
Lord God, there are so many things in our lives that we can sometimes be overwhelmed by. And frankly, we don't have the strength or the wisdom to carry. And so in this moment, I just ask that you would take all that is weighing us down, all the brokenness, all the pain, all the disappointments, all the lost dreams, that you would just take them and carry them for us, Lord. And that instead from you, we would get grace, mercy, peace, and healing. It's in your wonderful name that we pray, Jesus. Amen. Only God can take our brokenness and make us whole. And if God is at work in you today and you need someone to pray for you, please reach out to us. You can go to crosspoint.tv/prayer to submit your request, and our online prayer team is available to pray with you. We're here for you and we love you. Please reach out if we can help you on your faith journey. Thank you all for joining us here today, and I hope you have an amazing week. We'll see you next time here at CrossPoint Online.